Okay, thank you very much. It is, in fact, a great honor to be invited to do this. And what I would really like to do today is first just start with a comment energized by the last experience, and that is that this experiment, if you will, is done by experimental scientists quite often, and that is when people gather at things like synchrotron facilities and have 2 or 3 days of beam time, and you get different groups of people together, and although they're doing experiments, they have a lot of time while the experiment is running to talk and strategize together, and really this sort of intense personal experience together with sleep deprivation and a complex group of people really occurs quite often in the experimental world. And it would be interesting perhaps to trace the sociology and trace some of the successes of it. So having said that, let me tell you a little bit about my background. I'm a physical chemist by training. I am a thermodynamicist, an experimental thermodynamicist who does calorimetry. I'm interested in the heat effects associated with reactions, primarily but not exclusively among solids, primarily but not exclusively in inorganic materials. And in fact, what I'll be talking about today includes hybrid organic-inorganic materials. And in a sense, what I'm interested in is what I sometimes ostentatiously call the basic question of solid-state chemistry. Shake up a group of atoms and what do you get? Do you always get that? Are there other configurations that are possible? Are they very different in energy? Is there a landscape? Is there a complexity? And those questions then occur as a function of composition, pressure, and temperature. And indeed, I have made contributions to things ranging from deep earth geophysics to material science, to solid state chemistry, to ceramics. But what I thought I'd talk about today is porous materials, because they're interesting, and because they're beautiful, and because we've been doing some things recently that I find quite exciting. And then I will end by just one little tidbit in a totally different topic, because again, I realize from some conversations earlier today that people may be interested in it. So we have a thermodynamics lab that essentially measures heat effects associated with chemical reactions. We have a unique calorimetry capability, both, if you will, physical and intellectual, in what we call the Peter A. Rock Thermochemistry Laboratory at Davis. I have a group of ranging between 20 and 30 people, depending largely on how many visitors we have at a given time. And I'm also involved very much in the Division of Mathematical and Physical Sciences as interim dean. So I'm seeing a lot of the big picture. We've been hiring people in fields from statistics to condensed matter physics. So I've been learning all sorts of fascinating things, but that's not today's topic. So, zeolites. One can pack particularly tetrahedral structures, structures involving, for example, a silicon atom linked to 4 oxygens. One can pack them in fairly dense repetitive structures, or more interestingly, one can create heterogeneity within the structure by essentially creating areas that are densely packed and areas that are tunnels, pores, interstices that really do not contain very many atoms. And these are two-dimensional renderings of some of these structures. One can make very pretty pictures of them. One can obviously make everything from wallpaper to fabric design. And perhaps, indeed, the beauty of these structures is part of the driving force of dealing with them. But basically, then, there are two types of regions. There are the regions where the atoms are closely bonded, and there are the regions between those closely bonded regions that can, in some cases, be 20%, 100%, 1,000% of the volume of the dense packed materials. And indeed, in the last decade, a series of materials that build upon similar principles but contain both inorganic and organic building blocks have been developed. And these are generally called metal-organic framework materials or hybrid materials. And whereas the zeolites are largely inorganic, the hybrid materials, of course, are a mixture. And what that lets you do is create a greater variety and a greater porosity. And if one looks at these materials, then they are typically isoreticular in the sense that they are cubic in basic structure. You have inorganic nodes, for example, of four zinc atoms that are linked through organic molecules, and the length of the organic molecule can dictate then the porosity of the material. And in fact, they then create structures which create a lot of open space. So using our calorimetric methodologies, we've asked the question of what is the energetic relationship of these various materials to a hypothetical or a real dense structure. In the zeolites, it's easy to say that something like SiO2 quartz crystals are the dense structures. In the other polymorphs, it's a little bit harder to say what they are. But by our calorimetric measurements, what we have found, and then we have the metal, the mixed materials, the hybrid materials in warm colors and the zeolitic materials in cool colors, we have some difficulty in saying what our zero of energy is, and we think that some of the offset between these different materials relates to that. But the important thing is that you can increase the porosity of the material, you can increase the volume of the material by a factor of 10 or 20, and you raise the energy of the material only by a couple times the available thermal energy. So these materials are thermodynamically accessible, and there's a lot of them. So they form then, if you will, a dense energy landscape of possible structures, and which structures you synthesize depend on the path of synthesis, and often one adds other constituents to the synthesis brew to favor one or another of these structures. And I think what the thermochemical data show is that the role of these structure-directing agents is more in the selection of particular structures rather than in the stabilization of one structure relative to another. So what we found then in these materials is some general conclusions we can draw, that there are many structures of the same or relatively the same energetics, that they form a dense energy landscape, that the ones that you make depend really on the cleverness of your synthetic pathway. And this indeed was good news for the zeolite synthesis people back in the mid-1990s when they were wondering how many structures are accessible, and perhaps finding these small energy differences really empowered them to get together with organic chemists and say, well, if we make a specific structure directing agent, what is the mechanism for making the structure? So my earlier comments on stability versus persistence, on kinetic versus thermodynamic factors, really in a way emanate from this point of view. So one can think of this perhaps as complexity, one can think of it as self-assembly, one can think of it as emergence, but the properties of these materials, of course, are fascinating because inside the pores, one can put water, one can put other molecules, one can sequester CO2, one can carry out chemical reactions. This, for example, processing of petroleum depends on these zeolite materials as catalysts for the cracking of long carbon chains to short ones. One begins to use these materials for drug delivery. There is sort of endless interest in them. But the materials that I showed you basically are different chemical compositions. So when I showed you that diagram, it shows the energetics, but it sort of averages over different chemical compositions. It would be very nice to address that issue with composition not being variable, with saying, can you form different polymorphs of the same composition? That is, things that are polymorphs or allotropes in the chemical sense that have the same composition in different structures. Certainly in the SiO2-based materials, that is the case. But up to recently, in the metal organic framework materials, that has not been the case because you got structures of different densities by having organic linkers of different lengths. And then you can say, you can question whether there's a chemical effect as well as a porosity effect. Well, over the last year, in fact, about a year ago at a Gordon conference in solid state in porous materials, we got together with a scientist in Montreal, Tomislav Frischich, who has been using unconventional synthesis materials, particularly grinding, mechanochemical synthesis, to make and transform materials. And this is fascinating, that by putting together some of the constituents of these materials, together with perhaps a little bit of organic solvent, and then grinding the heck out of it, he can get chemical reactions to make materials in much shorter times than by conventional synthesis. And furthermore, if he keeps grinding them, he gets transformations at constant composition to materials of different structures. So here, for example, for some of the metal organic frameworks, are some of the transitions that are seen with grinding. And indeed, one forms then three or four or five different polymorphs, whereas by conventional chemical synthesis, one forms only the first one that is formed. And it is interesting that the conventional one is the one that is formed first under these mechanochemical conditions. And then with increased grinding, other polymorphs are formed. So now the question is the grinding putting higher energy into these materials and making less stable materials? Or is it enabling these materials to undergo transitions by overcoming kinetic barriers? The materials that are formed in sequence are of higher density, so the diagram that I showed at the beginning would suggest that they are lower in energy, but perhaps they are not. So over the past month, really, we have obtained some of his samples, and we have looked then at the question of what is the energetics. So we see, for example, and this comes from our data, that the initial material formed, which is the one that can be made by other methods, is higher in energy by 20 to 30 kilojoules per mole. But now the two other samples that we have run are in fact lower in energy, and the densest one is the lowest. So we conclude from this that indeed what grinding does is enables nature to overcome the barriers and to come down, if you will, in an Ostwald rule of stages or Ostwald step rule sense, or in a sense then that one looks at and samples phases of increasingly greater stability, lower energy, until one comes down to the most stable one. And it is fascinating, and I think not well understood, why the mechanochemical synthesis works this way. And indeed then, if we compare our energetics of these materials with other metal organic frameworks, again, we have some offsets because the zero of energy is hard to define what is the most stable phase, but we see the same sort of trend, and we see the same sort of trend that as you go toward the more stable material, you basically go toward a material that is of higher density and that has been enabled by this mechanochemical synthesis. So what this effectively tells us is, again, that the ability to make new materials depends on the pathways for making them, that there is a very dense energy landscape of possible materials of very similar energies, and that really at this point, the question of synthesis and persistence is almost more important than the question of thermodynamic stability. The thermodynamic stability is not a limiting factor. Well, I was going to initially end my talk here, but I would like to take maybe 2 minutes to discuss something different that we have been working on. There is a lot of interest right now in various perovskite structure materials for solar cells. The perovskite structure is a dense structure known well for oxides. It essentially contains a framework of octahedra with some sort of positive ion in the center of these octahedra, and then some sort of large positive ion in the center of the interstices created by the linkage of these octahedra. And then the structure itself can be cubic, in which case the ion in the center is coordinated by 12 oxygens, or it can distort to make that ion coordinated by fewer oxygens. And we and other people have done a good deal of thermodynamic studies of the inorganic perovskites and find that one of the major factors in determining their thermodynamic stability is, in fact, the degree of size mismatch, the degree of not being able to get the optimum bond length in both the octahedral and the central site, something that is known as the Goldschmidt tolerance factor. Well, there has been interest in the last year, or 2 years really, in a series of hybrid perovskites, of perovskites where the cation in the central site is a large organic cation, for example, tetramethyl ammonium and nitrogen with four methyl groups on it, and then an overall positive charge. Then the ion in the central, in the octahedral site, is a polarizable soft ion like lead, lead 2 plus, and then basically the other anions are halides, chloride, bromide, iodide, and particularly the tetramethyl ammonium lead iodide seems to hold all sorts of records for its ability in solar energy, and there is a lot of theoretical work on it. But these materials are of limited stability in the sense that they are very sensitive to reaction with water, to reaction with oxygen, to reaction triggered by the formation of defects, for example, induced by radiation, by solar radiation, by ultraviolet. And much of the work that people are doing is thinking about how to prevent those reactions, how to encapsulate the materials. But our thermochemical studies give one even worse news. So I will basically communicate some bad news for the solar energy community here. And that is, we have measured the enthalpy of formation of these perovskites, the tetramethyl ammonium lead chloride, bromide, and iodide materials. We find then that their formation, simply from their binary constituents, tetramethyl ammonium halide and lead halide, is moderately favorable for the chloride, right at the edge of unfavorable for the bromide, and substantially unfavorable for the iodide. Indeed, so unfavorable, about 20 kilojoules per mole for the iodide, that no entropy effects can get you out of that. So our contention is that even without water, even without air, even without radiation, these materials are the tetramethyl ammonium iodide material, tetramethyl ammonium lead iodide material, is likely to decompose in use. The question then is, at a temperature of a couple hundred degrees on your rooftop, how fast will it decompose, even if it doesn't react with water or air? And the reason I bring this up is really threefold. One, it shows you what experimental thermodynamics can do. Sometimes it's a cautionary tale. Two, it gives data that can be compared with computational results, and indeed the computation results are in the same ballpark. Some say that the material is marginally stable, some that is say that it is marginally unstable. I think we have proven that it is unstable. And the third is, you say, well, what is thermodynamics good for? Thermodynamics is an enabler. It says that for the porous materials, the thermodynamic driving forces are favorable and the difference between different structures is small enough that it can be overcome. Thermodynamics is also a policeman. It says certain materials are intrinsically unstable and eventually they will come back to bite you. So those are the sorts of things we're interested in. We have many other projects we're working on, but I thought that these two would give you the flavor of what we do. Thank you.
Yeah, my material science is a bit rusty, but one of the big things is trying to make these high temperature sensors. And do you think this kind of research opens up new avenues where the sort of high thermal kinetic environment could sort of kick you into these new states that would be hard to reach otherwise? And so you could use them as sort of large scale thermocouples or something like that.
Exactly. There are many materials that you can make under extreme conditions, and we are interested in them. And some of them, another unanswered question, is some of them can be brought back down to ambient condition without transforming, and some of them cannot be. And whether your extreme conditions are ultra-high pressure temperature, ultra-high temperature, ultra-high pressure, in fact, we've got projects involving neutron and X-ray studies of these materials at high temperature, and we have a new calorimeter that we've built that will enable one to get thermodynamic properties of materials up to much higher temperatures than previously known. And that gets you into aerospace technology and leading edge of reentry vehicles and thermal barrier coatings, et cetera, et cetera.
Thank all our speakers from this morning again, and